Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here again. I hope that you have a nice first day and second morning. And today I'm going to bring back to molecules and to tell you a story regarding the development of a new molecule that we started synthesis in Coimbra University, and then it was translated to a spin-off. As I mentioned yesterday, in my group, we are interested in the development of new molecules, particularly tetrapyrrolic macrocyclics, for medicinal applications. So my group is a synthetic group, but fortunately we have collaborations in Coimbra and in other parts of the world that evaluate our molecules. As I mentioned yesterday, our main goal is regarding the development of new tetrapyrrolic macrocycle-based compounds for photodynamic therapy, for photodynamic inactivation of microorganisms, and also for imaging. Yesterday, I was thinking to show you some examples of each part, but unfortunately, I will not have time to the imaging, but I will be next year in the Porphyrin World Congress in the United States, and maybe we can discuss that, or here in the corridor. So today, as I mentioned, I'm going to tell you the story of the development of radaporfin, that it's a stable bacterochlorine with an easy synthetic process, and that is totally available by synthesis. As I mentioned to you yesterday, there are several bacterochlorines, like Tucat, that are in clinical, but some of them start from natural products. Finally, I will show you just a bit of how we modulate new compounds for photodynamic inactivation of bacteria. It's really not the same approach. We need to think about the cellular membrane, so it's a different approach. Okay, as I mentioned yesterday, I told you several methodologies for the synthesis of meso-tetraaryl porphyrins. And if you remember, I said that it's important to have halogen atoms in order to populate the triplet state with the appropriate energy. And so they can transfer energy to the oxygen and to form reactive oxygen species. But yesterday I promised that today I will go to show you how we modulate the amphiphilicity of the compounds, because all the compounds that I showed you yesterday, they cannot be used in a biological medium because they just have this structure, is very, very hydrophobic, and so it's impossible to use them. So we introduced specific chains in order to improve its biocompatibility, and we are now starting to introducing specific vectors in order to obtain bioconjugates for targeting. Finally, I will show you the methodology, a new methodology that using an easy process, we can reduce these two double bonds and obtain the bacterochlorines. The main problem of these bacterochlorines and that have not been used, for example, the reason why Foscan is a chlorine and not a bacterochlorine is because the bacterochlorine of Foscan is very, very unstable. So, after mixing pyrrol with the desired aldehyde in acetic acid nitrobenzene, more recently in the presence of this Lewis acid catalyst, as I mentioned, we have been able to prepare all these compounds with chlorine or fluorine atoms. I'm not mentioning today the brominated porphyrins because that one does not have the appropriate energy level of the triplate state, so we didn't use them. But the idea is to modify this structure. So we did just a simple aromatic electrophilic reaction with chlorosulfonic acid. So if we mix this aromatic compound with chlorosulfonic acid, fortunately, we have been able to prepare this chlorosulfonic group directly. So instead of doing the sulfonation followed by the addition of the chlorine atom with thionyl chloride, this methodology allows us to obtain this compound in just one step. And it's very easy to manipulate because we have this strong acid and we have this compound, but this compound is soluble in organic solvents. So if we do continuous extraction with water, we will take out the acid and the other compound is still in the organic phase. And it's also easy to check if the reaction is going well because firstly, this is protonated and this is green. And after washing, it starts to be red. That's the real color of the porphyrin. Okay, if we have this chlorosulfonated compound, it can easily react with several nucleophiles like water to give the sulfonated compound, with amines, so we will obtain the sulfonamides, with alcohols, we obtain the sulfoesters, and also with thiols. But as I mentioned yesterday, the presence of this group is an ideal group to do easy bioconjugations because if we have biological molecules with appropriated nucleophiles, they can attach directly at room temperature, so no problems with this linkage. So at this stage, at the porphyrin stage, it's very, very easy to obtain bioconjugates. We already did start to do some, but I'm not telling because they are unpublished results. Okay, having this compound, so versatile compound that can give us several families, we decided to go further to try to reduce these two double bonds in order to obtain the amphiphilic bacterochlorine. Obviously, we start with the classic Whitlock methodology, like Foscan. So the approach that they prepare Foscan industrially is just to use paratoluene sulfonyl hydrazine as hydrogen source, and will produce diamide in the presence of a base. And in the case of Foscan, they use pyridine, and we avoid pyridine by obvious reasons, and we use DMF, and this gave us the bacterochlorine. But I should say that under these conditions, the reactions, it's not reproducible. Sometimes we have the compound, sometimes we don't have the compound. Okay. And we start thinking if, in these conditions, if we need the use of toxic solvents like pyridine or even DMF. And looking to some papers in the literature and following our proposals of development of green chemistry, using green chemistry principles for our synthesis, we agree with this TOLDA paper regarding the development of solvent-free organic synthesis. Why we need always the use of a solvent? Today it was a bit discussion here, and really the solvent is to put together the molecules in order to react and to give the transformations. But Maybe some of you know better than me that we can have transformations, solid-solid transformations, like Klebermann mentioned about the co-crystals and other solid-solid transformations. And we can have other approach that if we have one molecule, another molecule, this one has a low melting point, this can melt, dissolve this one, and then the reaction may occur. So we need to go ahead this Aristotle philosophy and think that it's possible to do reactions without solvents. So this principle, we mix just this porphyrin that it's a solid with a very high melting point, but with the pyroglutaminosulfonylidazine that has a low melting point, about 120 or around 100, and we mix them in a reactor. It's obvious that we need to be careful because this may liberate hydrogen and may be explosive, so we need to be to have some to do these reactions in appropriate vessels. So when we mix this, just this, we heat it up until 150 degrees, and without any solvent, without any base, we have been able to obtain our reduced compound in quite pure form. This is the visible spectra. As you can see, we have a strong band around 750, so in the near infrared, which is really a good point. And the interesting point is that this compound can be purified by extraction with bases, no problems, and can also be purified by chromatography. So it's a bacteriochlorine stable. Why is this, and why Foscan, that it's exactly the same, but with an OH in here, why this one is very, very liable? It's easy to think, if we look to these groups, they are very electron withdrawing groups, and so the oxidation of this compound is more difficult. So, just think about a few words about the mechanism. So we have the pyroglutaminosulfonylhydrazine. It's just our hydrogen source. So by heating, it forms this hydrogen bonding, internal hydrogen bonding. We obtain the acid and the diamide. Is this compound only in the cis form that is able to transfer the required hydrogen atom to our double bonds. So here is the mechanism. We have the hydrazine. We put two hydrogen atoms in here and another two hydrogens in the opposite. And we just liberate nitrogen. So it's an easy synthesis because we can wash the solution with a base, take out the acid, and we have the pure compound. I had this movie, but unfortunately, it depends. Yesterday it works, today it doesn't work. So this is a really interesting mechanism insight using thermal microscopy. This is the porphyrin, this is the hydrazine, and when we heat up, we can exactly see the melting of the hydrazine, dissolve the porphyrin, and then the nitrogen bubble. But sorry, I cannot show it to you. So it's the porphyrin, this is the hydrazine, it melts, dissolve this one, and then the reaction occurs. So it's a very easy reaction. And I'm going to tell you the right story, because this is not exactly what happened. You are young guys, and I would like to say that life is important. We must be in the lab. I always say to my students, you shouldn't put a reaction and go out because it's not good. But one day, after 1 year trying to solve this problem, I had a student that preferred beer than work in the lab. And so instead of doing what I used to say to him, he just put the reaction and went out. We had a problem in the water of the lab, and so in the day after, there's no solvent in the reaction medium. And he appeared in my office saying, oh, what can I do? I don't have solvent in the reaction. Shall I put another one? And I answer, B, but please do a visible spatter just to have a look. And surprisingly, on that day, we obtained the bacterochlorine that before we repeat the reaction 20 or 30 times and no bacterochlorine. So I start to think about that, and the only possibility was because we didn't have solvent. So after that, we moved to the absence of solvent. So this means that a bad reaction, a great discovery, can come from the interpretation of the results, and is not always so easy. Okay, if you want to see the movie, you can find it in the Green Chemistry paper that we published with these results. Okay, after having this in hand, we decided to go ahead. We patent the process and the compounds, and we fortunately we have a Portuguese pharmaceutical company, Blue Pharma, and we have Portugal Ventures that inject some money, and so we from university to industry, and we opened a spin-off. So first we decided to pair a very large family of compounds, and we combine the two chlorine atoms, one chlorine atoms, one fluorine atoms, two fluorine atoms, and just reacting with the alcohols, we obtain sulfoesters, and if we react them with amines, we obtain sulfonamines, a large family. I should say that the sulfoesters are particularly unstable regarding hydrolysis. But a question from yesterday from somebody here, this may be a good point, because this may we can inject these compounds and maybe they go inside the cell and they can move from less polar to more polar, and maybe we somebody specialist on that can introduce these compounds in the specific organelles in the cells. I don't know, but these are more liable. So then, after having all this family, we decided to check the scale-up, and we have been able to prepare under GMP conditions 250 grams. Then we analyzed its stability against oxygen and also pH changes, and is really stable. We also tried obtained the ethanol water coefficient, and it's really interesting because we can move from log P of negative log P to a very positive one. And one thing that maybe somebody in the audience or some or in your universities can give me the answer, I still don't know, is that this compound with a large alkyl chain, the heptyl chain, is much, much more stable. Is comparatively to the porphyrin. So maybe this chain just protect the oxidation in that hydrogens. I don't know. Maybe some theoretical calculations may give us the answer. But this gives you an idea that we can have compounds with quite different lipophilicities that can be used for quite different purposes. Then we analyzed in collaboration with Janusz in Poland and Luis Arnaud in Coimbra. They did all the photophysical studies, and as you can see, some they have good oxygen singlet formation, but it depends of the also of the structure. And we also, Janus also observed by EPR that there's some ROS formation. So this means that they can, in regarding PDT use, they can for use both mechanisms, type 1 and type 2. Okay, if we look to photofrin absorption pattern to the lucitine, or now called rhodopsin, here we have this strong band in the infrared region. And like Kleber mentioned yesterday, this doesn't mean that an ideal photosensitizer should always have NIR absorption. It depends of the purpose, because for dermatological purpose, we don't need that. This is just for internal diseases, that if we want that the light penetrate in the tissues. We also did all the in vitro studies in lucitine, but then we repeat them in GMP laboratory, and we obtained quite good IC90 for several types of cells, human colon, human prostate, mouse melanoma, human breast carcinoma, human non-small cell lung carcinoma. So we obtained quite promising results with several types of cells. Then we move to in vivo studies, and first we analyze its dark toxicity, and apparently our mouse are always happy. We just don't give it more because we don't have a lot. By that time, we didn't do the upscales, and so we don't want to spend more, but it's no danger, no toxic. We also study the pharmacokinetics, and this is the reason of tumor muscle is 4, so a great selectivity for tumors, and tumor skin is also quite high, but quite lower than, for example, photofrin. So in our case, when this is different point. So this means that in our case, the accumulation in skin is not a big problem. We also studied its transdermal accumulation, permeation, and in 3 hours we can observe some compounds inside. So this can be also used for dermatological purposes. Obviously, what is needed is to do development of the appropriate, the appropriate vehicle to do this formulation. I mean. Okay, then we also did, this is Luis Arnoux, we also did the pharmacokinetics in mini pigs, and by that time we used 2 milligrams per kilo, but in the human, as you will see, it is effective with quite less doses, and the metabolism of excretation was very good. So after 3 days, almost no compound is in the body, in the animal. And we move to do some photodynamic in vivo studies, and this is the control, and we implant a tumor. We did just one treatment, and then after 1 month, the animal is still okay, and the tumor didn't grow more. In here, we described the irradiation after 24 hours, but now we know that it's not necessary. There's strong accumulation, so in vivo, in clinical trials, we did it after 15 minutes or less. So after, as all you know, so we need to do for the development of a new drug, we need to do the in vitro studies, and then we need to choose the lead compound. And so after regarding to the photophysical properties, I mean the formation of HORS, oxygen singlet, and HOR radicals, after analyzing its photostability. It's an important point that I would like to mention, because I think somebody yesterday also mentioned this. A photosensitizer is not very important that it is very, very stable. We should have moderate stability, because we want that it's stable until we do the photodynamic action, but after that, ideally, it should be decomposed to be eliminated. So that's why, for example, these bacteroclorines, when we compare them to porphyrins, are much better, because they are stable enough, much more stable, for example, than the 2-cad molecule, but are not so stable as photofrin or other, or the precursor porphyrin. So they are eliminated from the body much more easier. So after looking to the dark cytotoxicity, the in vitro PDT effect in the mouses, the in vivo in cells, the in vivo PDT effect, and also, very, very important, the tumor selectivity, we have been able to choose our lead compound. That really is a bacteroclorine with two fluorine atoms in each short opposition and this short sulfonamide group. So this is, we can inject them directly just using a small amount of chromophore and polyethylenoglycol as for the pharmaceutical composition. Oh, and this is what now we hold and patent as radaporfin. So then, obviously, we need the appropriate device, because we need to irradiate in a specific position, ideally in this NIR region. And we agreed with the Omicron, and they provide to us a laser with the specificities that we needed. The biggest step and the more difficult step was to get approval for start clinical trials, and we got approvals for phase 1-2 of in patients that are in terminal stage. So this is a doctor in the hospital of Porto, Dr. Luis Santos, and he is doing the treatment. This is a clinical case. This is horrible, with a man of 63 years that was that did chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and everything, and now decided to come here as volunteer. So we did an intravenous infusion of 0.5, 75 mg per kilo of radaporfin. And since this is so big, the treatment was done in several regions. As you can see here, we can observe the necrosis of the tumor. And after that, the patient was submitted to a combination of this PDT with immunotherapy. And I'm glad to show you that after 2 years, the man is still very happy in the garden. For me, this is one of the most important parts of my academic career, because life is very important. Thank you. Okay, so this is a story where the Catalyst and Fine Chemistry Laboratory was involved. We contributed to the startup. And this is also another important part of the story, is that several of my students start their career in this Lucitine. And so we prepare this compound. Later on, one of the most difficult parts was the development of the analytical process. It was very, very difficult. The guys from the analytical always said that it's not pure, because they saw a lot of peaks. And what happens? This compound, we have the molecule, and we have the final groups in here. But that sulfonic groups, due to the fluorine atoms, the sulfonic groups can be up or down of the ring. And so what we may have in a pure compound is a mixture of at least four what we called atropiisomers. It depends on the temperature if they can rotate or not. That's an indirect rotation around the plane of the porphyrin. And so, as you can see here, we can have these possibilities. So we can have one group down, three, one up, one down, one up. Or we can have two down, two up, one alternatively, or all four groups for the same size. And apparently, why is this interesting? Now we patent this, and I think that this may be another very important part for the future of the use of these compounds, because we observed that these molecules does not have exactly the same photodynamic effect. And I think that now there's several students and teachers in this room that knows better than me the reason. We guess that these different structural modifications will conduct to a different internalization in different position of the cells, and so with consequent different mechanism. We had another problem, and the problem was how to identify these atropoisomers. We separate them by HPLC, but what was not an easy job to identify them. And if we look to this pattern, is HPLC, I say. We have A, B, these are the two possibilities, C, this one we know that which is it, but apparently D, this is a silica column, so we decided to mention that this one must be the most polar. But if we look to this of solvents. If we have the mixture of atropoisomers dissolved in organic solvent, dichlormethane, for example, and if we add hexane, what we obtained was a precipitate and a solution. And if you look to the HPLC of the solution and of the precipitate, after dissolving it again, obviously, we can see that that one is enriched in the C and D, and this one we have more A and C. So we think that obviously these are AB must be more polar and C and D less polar, which apparently is in contradiction with the other HPLC. But fortunately, we have been able to obtain a crystal of the atropoisomer, so the one that has all the four groups for the same size, And so we didn't have doubts about that one. And after that, we did all the characterization. What we think that is going on as in the silica, this one that has the same groups, the sulfonamide groups from the same size, will interact more with silica, and we have on that side a different, more hydrophobic region. So this may be a great fixture for internalization in different organelles in the cells. Okay, after having this separate, we decided to analyze its photodynamic effect. And as you can see in here, they have quite different photodynamic action. Red, we have the mixture of the compounds that I call here LUS11 or radaporfin. It's a mixture of all the compounds. And then blue, we have A, almost no effect or less effect. B, similar to the radaporfin. And C and D, much better. Particularly D, that has all the groups for the same size. If you look to the photochemistry, it's not so different. The absorption coefficient change a bit, but the oxygen singlet doesn't change a lot. So this is not the reason for the formation of different amounts of oxygen species is not the reason for these particularly different results. So we think that is really a different interaction and the permeation to different organelles. One problem, when we did that studies, we just had a SME preparative HPLC in the lab. And so to obtain a few MIGs, we may need 1 or 2 months. So to said we shouldn't patent this because it's impossible to go to did the transposition from this academic study to a practical approach. But it's not true because meanwhile we bought this preparative HPLC and it's fantastic. So we can obtain in a half an hour several grams without any problems. So and exactly with the same distribution, and this is automatically, so we don't have to do anything, and we obtain. Now we have easily large amounts of each atropoisomer. We are pursuing studies regarding internalization and also regarding its photodynamic effect in order to understand the mechanism, but I cannot explain more than this. So Lusitin, the spin-off, Huawei is a company that emerged from university and a partnership with Blue Pharma, that it's a pharmaceutical company, and some private money. We have the proof of concept in clinical trials phase 1-2. Now, unfortunately, I should say that I don't know where we are because we need money, and in Portugal it's not easy to get money. It's in several parts of the world, but in a small country it's even more difficult. So we developed the LUS11 or radaporfin until phase 1-2. We have another patent for a good compound for acne, and also a new molecule for photodiagnosis. Okay, this is this part of the story, and now I just have 2 or 3 minutes just to show you a recent project that we are developing with collaboration with Brazil regarding the design and the synthesis and of new molecules for trying to solve the problem of bacterial resistance. This is really a global problem. I should say that maybe now is even worse than cancer, because cancer, several new approaches appeared in clinical, and now the number of deaths diminish significantly. But in the case of deaths due to bacterial infection, is not solved. If you look to this map, we can see that in Asia, Africa, and also in Latin America, the number of deaths is terrible due to infections, and by 2050, this will increase significantly. So the World Health Organization is now also making reports and trying to alert that politics should invest to the development of new therapies and new antibiotics. The classic era of antibiotics is out. So it's urgent the development of new molecules or new antibiotics, alternative therapies, and we think that new photosensitizers for photodynamic inactivation is a good solution, since until now, there are several papers in the recent 10 years, I should say, and until now, there is no evidence that the bacteria will make resistance due to this use of ROS to kill them. Just an example of the consumption of antibiotics in Europe, and particularly in Portugal, is in the middle. And I think that simultaneously to the development of new approaches, new antibiotics, we should also think about education, about changing the use and abuse of antibiotics by humans and also in veterinary cases. Okay, just to finish, the design of photosensitizers for PDE is different from PDT. Because you know better than me that the external cellular chain is membrane is different from gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria, and one of the main problems of the antibiotics that are in the market is really to kill gram-negative bacteria, because they have these two different membranes with different chains. So it is in our approach we thought about preparing different porphyrin type molecules with different sizes and with different charges, positive charges, in order to obtain can cross this membrane. And also, as you know, one of the main problems is the development of biofilms around the bacteria, and so the antibiotics cannot go through. So it's important to look to the size and to the appropriate structure. So we are now preparing compounds of this type and also some phthalocyanin types with positive charge. If we prepare these, they will be for dermatology, for external application. In this case, if we have the NIR absorption, we can use them for other purposes. So we prepared several positive charges based and that have been very, very effective for destruction or for killing gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. So when we try to contribute to give an answer for increasing or for giving a solution for PDI, we think that a combination of new, the development of new photosensitizers with appropriate devices, namely, now we have a family of cationic, imidazole porphyrins, and phthalocyanins, or even curcumin, and we observe a strong effect of size, positive charge number, and the metal. We have quite promising results regarding gram-negative or, and even the avoiding of biofilm formation. So I don't have time, so Carolina and Rafael are some of my students, and next week they will have some details about this. So I think that the collaboration between this project, between Coimbra and the Van der Leij group will give some news in the literature soon. Okay, in summary, I should say that this is an example, an history of the development of a new molecule that starts in the university with a bad student, and then we developed the startup, belong to industry, and so I think that all of us should think that it's very important that if we can give a contribution for the society. So fundamental research is important, but if we can translate it, it's also one message that I want to give to these young guys that are in this room. Okay, just a bit of Portugal. You are all invited to come to Coimbra and to do some of these compounds if you are interested. So this is Portugal, a very small country, much smaller than São Paulo. And in Portugal, we have the Lisbon, Coimbra, Évora, and other cities. This is our some views of Lisbon, is a nice old city. This is Coimbra. I should say that this is the one of the oldest universities of the world, 729 years old. And that in this room here, we have a beautiful room, and is the place where the student has to do the PhD, dressing black ties, and is like a theater. This is another interesting cities, Porto, Évora, Madeira, and so on. This is my group that I showed you yesterday. I should thank all of them, particularly Carolina, Rafael, and Lucas that are working on these fields, and Vanessa that is here is doing new molecules for imaging. This is Louis Arnaud. It's very important for us because he's a photobiologist, and so we can have the answers and some ideas for the design of new molecules. This is the Lucitin team. Here is our CEO, that is Claudia, is Luis Arnaud, myself, and here is the head of Blue Pharma, the pharmaceutical company. I should thank all the sponsors. And finally, I would like to give you a final message that mesoaryl tetrapyrolic macrocycles are very, very promising photosensitizers for PDT and PDI because due to the its easy synthesis and its easy structural modulation. But I think that one of the best things of a teacher is have the opportunity to talk to the students, because the formation, the examples that we give is also very, very important, because it's not only the fundamental research inside the lab, but also what we teach and the examples we give to the students. I think that it's also one important part of our career. And like yesterday, today, I still reinforce the idea that this multidisciplinary biophotonics school is very, very important to have the opportunity to talk together and to arrange collaborations. So, one important part is really innovation, and I also promise to you and that I will do all what I can to influence politics, that it's very, very important that they give better conditions for young researchers. I think that postdocs after postdocs after postdocs is not a good situation, and I think that teachers and should influence the politics to move and to change a bit these ideas. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Marietti. Questions? No questions? Is everyone awake?
It's time after
lunch.
Yeah.
Right,
so. I'm here all the week, so.
No questions?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the talk. I have a question about the how the photo how it's used for killing bacteria. How do you use the photosensitizer to kill the bacteria?
To kill the bacteria?
Yeah.
How we use it?
Yeah.
Is that the question? Okay. It's not my job, as I mentioned, I'm from the synthetic part, but my student, Caroline, and here in São Carlos, so they did several approaches. One is in solution, in plankton form, so they put the bacteria to go, and after we introduce the photosensitizers, and we radiate them with the first in the dark, and then with the appropriate light source. We did this in this type of bacteria, E. coli, and also with positive charge, so both type. And we obtain one of the best results that are in the literature to kill the bacteria. But here in São Carlos, they also observe that they inhibit the growth of biofilms, which is also very, very important. More details you can ask in the posters. It's unpublished results. I didn't show everything because we need to publish first.
Can I?
Thank you very much for your presentation. I would like to know, in coming back to my question of yesterday, so if I understand, it's the configuration, because you say that the radaporfin has got A and D configuration. So is it the configuration which determines which intracellular routes routine that the photosensitizer will take?
Take?
Yeah.
Yeah, from the tropoisomers, we have now results that I didn't show that confirm that depending of the structural orientation of the sulfonamide groups, they will go to different parts of the cells, so they go inside the cells to different organelles, and they have different mechanisms of action.
And is this after repeated experiment, they continuously go to the same?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me. Sorry. you using zeolite in your investigation, what is the main reason you plan to create, you using zeolite in your investigation? Question to
yesterday.
Previous yesterday lecture. Yeah. What is the main reason you plan to create complex preparation with these minerals, or you use these minerals as catalytic agents?
Yeah. Before, when we start that work, our main purpose was to develop new catalysts for oxidation reactions. And the idea was to protect the tetrapyrrolic macrocycles against oxidation. That it's one of the main problems for the transposition from the laboratory to the industry. So it's very important to develop a new oxidation catalyst, but this oxidation by themselves, it's a problem. And so first we start with that. Now we are preparing other nanostructures that, for example, carbon nanotubes, we know how to modify them and to attach photosensitizers. And so now we are interested also to collaborate to use it in medicine. So, and we have several compounds. If you are interested, I can show you.
Okay. Thank you.
One other question here.
Hi, so it seemed like you encountered a lot of challenges when you were translating Lucitin. So it seemed like you encountered a lot of challenges while you were translating Lucitin from academia into the clinic. And I was just wondering, what was the most difficult? Oh, sorry.
Sorry. It's my foot.
So it looks like you had a lot of difficult challenges when you were trying to get Lucitin into the clinic. And I was just wondering, what was the most difficult part?
From to go from the university
to the industry.
Really, we didn't have big troubles for the first moving from the university to the industry because we were lucky and we obtained funding, and so we start the work without troubles. The first step, because we don't need a lot of money in the first step of the development. But then, to go ahead, so we need to contract a doctor in order to do all the regulations to apply for clinical trials. And another difficulty is, because all the studies we did in Lucitin were repeated in a GMP lab, because we are not a GMP lab. And so it's very, very expensive. So we give everything. I went to Netherlands to explain how to do the reaction, and we paid quite a lot of money to do this translation. So translation from a normal lab to a GMP lab is very, very expensive. Then for this one, two clinical trials is also a big step, but the next step because we need much more patients, and so we need millions, and so is the money is the difficulty money. Now. Is that the question?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.